Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful that we can come into the house of God today. Experience your power and your presence, Lord. How good it is to be in the house of God. Lord, today as we approach your word, we pray that you open it up to us. In fact, Lord, open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly, Lord, we acknowledge that today it's not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine, God. But rather, it's your Holy Spirit who is the teacher of this church. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all of our brothers and sisters in the Lord that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ, here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. God, they're our brothers and sisters, and we bless them. In no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. God, it doesn't matter if they're denominational, non-denominational, God. Lord, if they're independent or they're linked up with an association, God, if they're preaching your gospel and your truth, Lord, we bless them this day, God. Also, Lord, we remember the persecuted church scattered abroad. Lord, we pray that you encourage them and strengthen them. May they endure to the end. And Father, we also lift up to you the nation of Nepal in the wake of this tragedy, God. We pray that you preserve lives, God, that you send aid and relief, God. But most importantly, Lord, that you break through that dark nation with the light of the gospel. Send laborers into the harvest field at this time. And may that place be changed for the glory of God. Lord, we thank you for salvation and blessing. God, we love you. In Jesus' mighty name, and everybody in agreement said,
amen.
Amen. Well, today, get your Bibles out and go with me to the book of Hebrews once again. We're still in verse number 6 in our series on the pursuit of God. This is going to be part number 4, and I'll review a little bit for you. But I would encourage you, if you haven't got a hold of part 1, 2, and 3, it's too good to miss. And so we have the CDs for you. If you want to pick up the CDs over there on the left-hand side as you exit, you'll see the CD counter head over there. You can pick up the CDs, and they charge what our cost is, like $5 or $6 per CD. But we also have them online absolutely free. You can go to the message archive. You can watch the videos. Or you can podcast them, put them on your smartphone, or burn them to a CD and listen to them on the way to work or something like that. But I would encourage you, get the Word of God, because it's going to bless your life. Now, before we get into part number 4 today, I thought it'd be kind of fun to just tell you a little joke. You guys heard the one about the two hunters that weren't too smart? You guys heard this one? Okay, there was two hunters. They weren't too smart, and they're running around, and they just can't get it together. They wanted to go hunting together, but from the moment they started, they were arguing. Just, you know, let's go east. No, we got to go west. That's where all the animals are. We're going to go hunt animals. We can't go east. Got to go west. Let's go up. No. You got to go down. Let's stay away from the water. No, the animals go to the water. They need to do it. And so they're just arguing, and they can't get it together. They're just not so smart about hunting, not so smart about life. And so finally, they're traveling, they're arguing, they're bickering, they're back and forth bantering, and finally they come upon some tracks. The first hunter says, aha, see, I told you, look, we found some tracks. I knew we should have gone this way. And the other guy said, no, you didn't. This was my thing, and these are great tracks, and I'm so happy that I found them. No, listen, these are tracks I found. These are deer tracks. Look at them, the deer tracks. And the other guy says, deer tracks? You've got to be crazy. These are not deer tracks. Those are certainly bear tracks, much too large to be deer. First hunter said, no way are they bear tracks. You're crazy. I mean, look how in line they are. That's how deer travel, just lined up, real small, real concise. No, that's not small at all. That's not lined up at all. I mean, look at how big they are. Look how wide they are. It's definitely bear. We need to get out of here before the bear comes and gets it. No, we need to track this, and we need to go find the deer. And so they're fighting and arguing, and wouldn't you know it, while they're fighting and arguing, the train came and hit them both. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 6. This is the pursuit of God, part number 4. Look at what it says. Hebrews 11, 6 says this. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is. You say, well, believe that he is what? Well, that he's God. That he's all that he says he is. And if he is God, then we got to approach him God's way, and that's through faith. It's impossible to please God without it. And it says, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so we've been talking about the pursuit of God, that we must diligently seek after God, that we're going to come to God, and we got to come to him a certain way. Remember in part number 1, Pastor Luke had talked about how his life was revolutionized when he had that revelation, that understanding That God is not some force out there in the heavenlies. No, that God is a person. And as a person, we can relate with God. We can know him. And therefore, it starts our pursuit when you recognize and realize that we can know God in an intimate way. Then we came back and we talked about how to chase after God. How are we to pursue God? That as God reveals himself, there's that revelation that requires from us a response. And therefore, if we're going to come to God, we got to come to God God's way. And that way is in diligent faith, that we got to believe God and that we got to be diligent about it. Then last time we were together, Pastor Luke once again brought a brilliant message talking about the benefits that when you find God, what comes with that? Well, the presence of God comes with that. We so desperately need the presence of God in our lives. And then the voice of God. We talked about primarily the way that you're going to hear the voice of God is through his word. Not just words on a page, but the word of God that comes alive, that God speaks to our hearts and God reveals his will and his counsel and the intimate, deep things of God. Now today we're going to build on those principles. And I want to start out with a statement because we're going to go somewhere with this statement today. Here's the statement. When you find God, you will never regret the pain that it took you to get to him. When you finally get a hold of God, you will never regret the pain that it took you to get to him. In other words, if you're going to chase after God, if you're going to come after God, it's going to cost you something. In fact, ultimately, when you read your Bible, you'll find out it's going to cost you your whole life. It costs you all that you are, all that you have, all that you ever will be in your pursuit of God. And along the road, along the path, on the hunt, there's going to be obstacles. There's going to be pitfalls. There's an enemy that's out there. There's things that take place, temptations and trials and pressures and problems, tribulation that you will encounter. Things that happen along the road as you're finding God. But when you finally get to God through all the pain, through all the process, you will never regret that pain that you went through. Why? Because it develops something on the inside of you. It actually heightens the hunt. It makes you want to chase after God so much more. You'll never regret it. Each and every time you get a hold of God in your life. And so I'm going to make a statement, and I want to complete this statement a couple of times today to show where we're going. The power of pursuing God comes with, in other words, there is a power of pursuing God. There's something that's good in our lives, but it comes with something. It costs us something. There's going to be some pain that we have to go through that if we can get a hold of these things in our life, we'll never regret it. Why? Because we'll end up with the presence and the voice of God in our lives. So today, the power of pursuing God comes with, number one, first of all, priority. First of all, right off the bat, the power of pursuing God comes with, number one, a priority. When you are searching for God, when you are pursuing God, there has to be a priority. If God comes second in your life, then God comes none in your life. Eventually, he's going to be out. Because the moment you dethrone God and put self on there, or put sex on there, or put your way on there, or put fame or fortune on there, put work on there, put family on there, put sports on there, now all of a sudden you have lost the trail. You are off of God. And therefore, it's going to cost us the priorities of our life. Now, if I could just give you a quick list, give you a quick priority list for our lives. It's very simple. It goes like this. Number one, if you had right at the top in big, bold, capitalized letters, G-O-D, God comes first in each and every one of our lives. Very simple. Second, if you're married, that would be your spouse, your husband or wife. They come second. If you're single, you're good, right? God's that husband to you. He's your all in all, right? Okay. Thirdly, after your spouse comes your children, all right? Then after your children comes your work or your ministry. So if your ministry is your work, that's the next priority. Or if it's your work comes first because you got to provide for your family. And then as you have time, you serve in the ministry. That's a quick priority list. God, husband or wife, children, work or ministry. Very simple. Now, we understand that and we get that, but the hard part about making a list like that is that we say, okay, God's number one, but right now I'm on my spouse. And we kind of forget God over there. Or here's God number one, but I got to work today, and therefore, God, you can take a back seat over here while I go to work, but I'll come back to you, God. You're number one. You're above all this, God, but we don't relate to God in those areas. Now, let me give you a different style of priorities, okay, for a second. I want you to imagine a rubber band, okay? You put that rubber band on a table, all right? You got the rubber band on a table. Now, take a marble, a large marble, okay? They were calling it a boulder or a smasher, I think, in the first service. Remember the big marble, right? You had the little ones, the cat's eyes and all that kind of stuff. Then you had the big one. I think it's called the smasher or something like that you flick the other ones out with, okay? Get that big marble, and I want you to place that in the center of the rubber band, Okay? Now you got the rubber band on the table with a marble in the center, okay? Now I want you to imagine little spokes, like spokes of a wheel, coming out from that marble, all right? That's your priorities now. Each and every one of those little compartments is a priority. Family, work, ministry, friendships, finances, future, dreams, vision, destiny, all that kind of stuff is all around that marble in there. Now, if you were to fix some points on that rubber band, but you said, okay, I'm going to focus on family right now, and you started to stretch that rubber band out this way. Think about it for a second. The family would get larger, but everything else would start to get tighter. Everything else would start to get smaller, right? You guys understand that? But notice the marble didn't change. See, that marble represents God in the center of your life. And your priorities, though your priorities may shift, right now I'm focused on family, but God is still the largest part of my family. Even though right now I'm going to go to work over here today, and family may shrink down because I'm not with them, but notice God still stays the same in the center of my work. See, whatever your priority is, even though the list is a great list and that needs to happen and you need to have that understanding that God is at the top, then it's your spouse, then it's your family, then it's your work. Also, we also need to have that understanding that anytime we stretch out one of those, God stays the same inside of that area of our life. You say, what does that mean? That means that when you go on the job, you're working for Jesus. You're finding out how to be pleasing to the Lord by pleasing an earthly master. That you're working as unto the Lord. That means that when you're with your family, that you're looking for God in your family, looking for God in your marriage, that you're putting God first in your finances, that you're bringing your tithe, you're bringing your offering, you're being a good steward, building the kingdom of God with the resources he's placed in your life. See, God should stay the number one priority, but also stay the same on the inside of your life. So neat. I remember a time where I was going on missions, and on these missions trips, I met a guy. His name was Dean. Dean went on the missions trip with us, and he was from England. Really great guy. Really challenged me and my understanding of God in a lot of areas. Really kind of helped me form some of my theology, some of my thoughts about God, and really expanded to getting me out of small thinking about God and really expanded my thinking to a great picture of how big God really is. Guy was a great guy, and I remember we were in St. Louis. We were getting ready to go on a missions trip, and so we had students that were flying in, and as the students flew in, it was our job to find them, okay? So we had pictures of them, we had papers with their names and pictures, and then to find them to get their bags and to get them staged so that they could go get on the bus and go to the training camp. So me and Dean were talking, we're remembering old times from the year before, we're there in the St. Louis airport. Now, Dean, being from England, didn't have all of the restaurants that we have here in the States. And so Dean's last trip, when he came out the year before, Dean discovered a restaurant chain called Taco Bell. Now, Dean not only discovered Taco Bell, but he found a love for the gordita. He didn't care if it was the cheesy gordita crunch, the spicy gordita, the double gordo gordita. He didn't care. If it was a Taco Bell gordita, he was all over. That's what he wanted for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So as Dean and I are chopping it up, we're talking, we're relating, we're remembering, we're having a good time, walking down memory lane, all of a sudden Dean has a thought cross his mind, and he says these words. He says, Daniel, have they got Taco Bell here in the airport? And I said, yeah, I think it's downstairs. Now Dean, immediately, they have? Everything changed. All of a sudden, his priority was no longer picking up students and making sure that they got taken to the training camp. Dean couldn't stand still any longer. Dean was bugged. He was nervous. All of a sudden, he's got a little twitch going on. You know, he needs something. You know, and I noticed a minute later, he's going over to one of the guys. Can you make sure that you find these three people? They're still coming. I don't know what plane. Can you just make sure, look at the picture, study them, and make sure you get them and get their bags and get them over to the stadium? I got to go do something. All of a sudden, Dean's gone. A couple minutes later, he's coming up the escalator licking his fingers, and he's got a little bit of sour cream and nacho cheese on the other side of his mouth. See, everything changed when he realized that they had Taco Bell downstairs at the St. Louis airport. In our lives, it's the same thing. See, you could look at work and you could say, oh, I hate work. My goodness, I hate going to the job. You know, the devil's on the job. We call them the boss, you know, and I just can't stand working for that ungodly person. And yet, someone might say, hey, but wait a second. Have they got God on the job? Oh yeah, God's on the job. And all of a sudden, everything changes. Now all of a sudden, you're excited to go to work. Now all of a sudden, it changes the world that you live in. My family's a drag. When we got married, it was great. It was the honeymoon, but now the honeymoon's over. And I'm waking up to someone I don't even know anymore. But guess what? God is in your marriage. And maybe you didn't realize it, but everything needs to change. You can't stay the same. You cannot have status quo, because the status quo is half of the marriages are going to end in divorce. But not so when you know that God is into marriage. Now all of a sudden everything changes. Now all of a sudden you can't stay the same. You can't be like the rest of the world. The priority has now shifted and changed, and now God is in the center of your life. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 33, great verse. We were there last week. You remember what it says? It says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. See, in our life, we search after a lot of things. We search after money. We search after housing. We search after clothing. We search after food. We search after provision. We search after a great life and a great marriage and great family. And yet God says, when you put me first at the top, when you put me in the center and you don't change my space, when you make me the center of everything in your life, seek me first, then everything else will be added unto you. You don't have to worry. Don't have to fear. Don't have to fret. Come on, that's good enough to give the Lord a praise for today. So the power of pursuing God comes with, number one, a priority. You got to place God first. Second thing is this. The power of pursuing God comes with passion. Power of pursuing God comes with passion. Can I say it to you like this? This is our sole purpose. This is everything that we are. We are locked in. This is our passion. Now, we understand passion in the world. We see people that are fanatics, right? Painting their houses the color of their sports team, painting their faces. They may not have the best physique, but in fact, they may like having a large physique because they can get the whole letter on their chest. And these guys go out there and they do this in a snowstorm. I mean, they're crazy. And yet we would laugh and we would say, look at those guys are passionate about sports. We see people that invest themselves. People have ruined marriages. People have lost loved ones. Why? Because they've gone after the pursuit of happiness in the form of a dollar. And they've gone after it. Why? They're passionate about making money, and everything else comes second to that. See, in our lives, when you're pursuing God, everything else comes second. That doesn't mean you have to lose your family. It doesn't mean you have to lose your mind. It means that you are now passionate, and that is your soul purpose inside of everything, like we were talking about in our priorities. Turn to me to the book of Psalms. Middle of your Bible is the book of Psalms. In the Psalms, the longest psalm is Psalm 119, really the longest chapter in the Bible, if you will. Psalm 119, right at the beginning. Psalm 119, the psalmist writes, verse number 2, blessed, everybody say blessed. Blessed. See, we're all looking to be blessed. We all want to have a blessed life. We want to have the capacity to succeed in our life. That's really what the blessing of God is. It's the capacity to succeed, that we can be successful. We can be blessed. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies. Look at the rest of the verse. Who seek him with the what? The whole heart. Not the half heart. Not the quarter heart. Not the I need to go fill up heart. Not the 99.9% heart. No, blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart. See, half heart, not going to make it. Not going to get you to your destination. Just like a half tank of gas, not going to get you there. See, you've got to seek God. And the Bible says, Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, you will seek me and you will find me when you search for me with your whole heart. Drop down to verse number 10. Look at this. With my what? Oh, let's try that again. With my what? Let's say it again with passion this time. With my what? With my whole heart, I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Why would he say that? Because it's easy for us to wander. Easy for us to get off track. Easy for us to get distracted. Oh my goodness, there's so many distractions. There's television and Disneyland and cell phones and the beach and the mountains and all sorts of other stuff that can get in the way. Even good things in our life can be a distraction to the God things in our life. And when your passion starts to wane, you better watch out, because next thing is your priority is going to start to change. So we got to keep ourselves hot. We got to stir it up. There's a great family in our church there. I won't point them out, okay? So I won't tell you that they're over here on the front row with their heads down. And I won't tell you that they're wonderful people that serve in our church and love the church. They're givers in our church. They're here every time the doors are open. And they're just neat people. And just, I love them so dearly. Just great people. And they were wanting to buy a dog at one time. And so they wanted to surprise their daughter, and so we went through a series of different things, and some things happened. So we ended up getting the dog and bringing it to our house, and they were going to come to our house and pick up the dog from us. And so they had this story. I think they said they were going to go eat some pizza. It was kind of a funny story, you know, and they end up in our neighborhood, you know, and they're going, what kind of pizza place is in the middle of a neighborhood, you know? And so anyways, they come to the door. Now, we had the dog with our kids there, and we're playing with the dog. Beautiful dog. I mean, just this deep black hair on the dog. You couldn't even barely see the dog's eyes. It was so dark, right? The only time you could see the eyes was when the light was shining off of it. So cute. So our kids, you know, they're just relating with the dog. They love the dog. And so, you know, like kids do, all of a sudden they're naming the dog. Oh, they should name him Shadow. Look how dark he is. Look how black he is. He would just be great. They should call him Shadow. No way. Look at the floppy ears. Isn't he cute? Oh, my goodness. They just bounce every time he walks. They should name him Floppy. Right? So finally they come and they rejoice and they're able to give the dog to their family and they're just loving on the dog. And so my kids come up and they say, hey, you know, I don't know if you picked out a name yet, but Shadow would be a great name. And then the other one steps in, oh, but I just noticed the floppy ears, and so I think Floppy would be a great name. And they said, no. We've already got the name picked out. Name is going to be Rocky. That's a cool name. Cool name for a dog. Rocky, come here. Rocky, come. Fetch Rocky. You know, that's a good name for a dog. You know, I thought maybe, you know, like some of you guys that watched the fight yesterday, maybe they're enthusiasts or they like the movie or something like that. Or maybe they're Stallone fans. And so, they're, you know, Rocky, that's a good name. So later on down the line, we're asking, hey, how's Rocky doing? Oh, he's doing good. He's growing. His fur's changing colors. He's now kind of silvery, this and that, and getting big, getting tall. And we're going through the pain of potty training the dog, you know. He had a couple few accidents, but he's good. He's good. And so, you know, we're laughing. But I said, well, hey, why did you name the dog Rocky? Is it because, you know, maybe you like the movie or something like that? And they said, no. Named after the Rock Church. I said, you religious fanatics, you. You guys are radical. But see, we need more people in church who will paint their face. We need more people who will buy the shirt. We need more people who will yell out of their car windows at perfect and total strangers just because they're in love with Jesus. We need to lose our mind a little bit and get a bit undignified on the job. We need people walking around the cube because they know they're going to get hit up about Jesus again. We need our relatives to be looking at the number when we call them on the phone, on the caller ID, to make sure, is it that preacher again that's going to tell me about Jesus? I already know that he loves me. My goodness, they're going to tell me again? See, we need to get passionate about the things of God. We need to light a fire on the inside of us. Too long, the church has been cold and apathetic, and that's why people are leaving the church. That's why people don't have any good life, and that's why people are running from God instead of to God, is because they see cold, dead religion, and they say, I don't want none of that. But see, when you light yourself on fire, everyone will come around to be warmed up by your glowing. That's what this is all about. It's about passion. We've got to stir ourselves, church. We can no longer stay a dead institution. We got to stir it up. We got to fan it into flame. We need a fresh breath of the Spirit of God and a wind to blow through the church like never before. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. We need tongues of fire going out. We need the dead to come to life. We need the leper to be raised up and healed. We need the people cleansed. We need the miracles, signs, wonders, gifts of the Holy Ghost. We need the real power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It comes because you seek after it, you pursue it, and you are passionate about it, every area of your life. Power of pursuing God comes with number one priority. Number two, it comes with passion. And finally, number three, so important. Number three, it comes with persistence. Persistence. Can I say it to you like this? The pursuit never ends. Just when you thought you got a hold of God, you realize, oh my goodness, he's gone. I got to seek him some more. Just when you thought you'd arrived, you realize that you were only at the base of the mountain. Just when you thought you had seen all there is to see and done all there is to do, you realize there's so much more to God that I haven't experienced yet. See, God is calling us onward and upward. Just like, you know, my family, we go to Yosemite every year. And there's a place up north part of Yosemite in the backcountry, the high country, where it's called Tuolumne Meadows. And there's a dome, big granite dome called Lambert Dome. Now, we'd driven by it a couple of times, and I thought, man, that's a very large dome. Well, this last year we decided we were going to go take a little hike to some soda springs. And so we're taking this hike, and as we take the hike goes right by Lumber Dome. And so as we're getting closer, we're drawing near to this big granite dome, I realized that's not just big, that sucker's huge. And as we got closer, I'm thinking, what are those little lines on the dome? Is that carvings? Is that, what is that? You know, maybe that's the glacier rub or something like that. And I realized, no, that's pine trees. There's little trees up on the top of this granite dome. And as we got closer, I said, what is that moving on the dome? That looks like little ants. It's people. There's people climbing that thing. Look how, oh my goodness. They're tiny compared to, and the closer we got, the bigger this thing got. See, it's no different with God. Here we are thinking that we know something about God. We know something about the Word. We know something about experience with God. And yet, the closer you get, the bigger God gets. The more you know, the more you realize, the less I know about God. My goodness, there's so much more. Turn to the book of Philippians chapter 3. The Apostle Paul writes, he's in prison. He's writing about the joy of the Lord, encouraging the church in Philippi. Philippians chapter number 3. One of my favorite sections of Scripture. The Apostle Paul is talking about how he had arrived in the natural sense. In the flesh, he had something to boast about. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews, born of the tribe of Benjamin, trained up by the best teachers, came from the right stock. He was a Pharisee. As far as religious zeal, he was persecuting the church. He says, even though he had all the accolades and all the approval of man, he says, even though I had all that in the world, when I met up with Jesus, changed everything. My priorities shifted, and now my passion is here. And because of that, he says, I count everything that I had in the world as loss. Count it all as dung, the old King James Version says. You know what dung is in the new San Bernardino translation? Poo-poo. Refuse. In other words, it's not only not worth my time or my energy, it's actually repulsive to me. Just go ahead and flush it. He goes on in verse number 10, and look at what he says. He says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. Verse 11, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. See, he says, if there's something in Jesus to be experienced, I want to have it all. Not only do I want to be following him, I want to suffer like him, and I want to die like him, and I want to be raised again like him. I want to have it all in my life. Verse number 12, not that I've already attained. See, we would have thought the Apostle Paul was the pinnacle. We would have thought on the earth, he did it all. I mean, this guy had dreams and visions. He was caught up into the third heaven. This was the apostle to the Gentiles. He's the great apostle that traveled and planted churches. He's the one who wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. If anybody should have arrived, it should have been the Apostle Paul. And yet he says, not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected. But I press on, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Maybe you had this experience in your Christian walk that you thought you found God. You thought you got a hold of Jesus. You thought that you had finally broke through, and then you look back and you realize, no, I didn't get a hold of God. God got a hold of me. I didn't find God. God found me. And you look back on your path and you see that every step was ordained of God, that God was hedging you in, that God was moving you, that God was moving things out of the way, that God was pulling obstacles out of the road and was leading you with loving kindness right down his path, right to where he is at the foot of the cross. See, and that's when you realize, God, you're drawing me. Therefore, God, I'm going to reach out. I'm going to grab a hold of that for which you've also grabbed a hold of me. Look at the next verse. Verse number 13, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. In other words, I didn't get a hold of God. I haven't yet arrived. But one thing I do, here's his priority, here's his passion. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, if the Apostle Paul, in prison, headed towards the end of his life, can say those words, how much more for us, church? See, we think we've been wrestling with God all night, just like Jacob. We think that we've got God. God, I finally got you. I got a hold of you. And God takes out one little finger, and he puts it on an area of our life, and all of a sudden, we're walking with a limp. See, you didn't get a hold of God. God got a hold of you. And you have not attained to God. No, God is saying, come on, child. Come on further. Come on. Come on, let's go, let's go, let's go. St. Augustine said this. He said, to fall in love with God is the greatest romance. To seek him, the greatest adventure, and to find him, the greatest achievement. Let me say it again. To fall in love with God is the greatest romance. To seek him, the greatest adventure. And to find him, the greatest achievement. See, the search never stops. The pursuit never ends. This is an ongoing thing in our lives, and you have to stay after it. I love the book series, The Chronicles of Narnia, written by C.S. Lewis. Recently, they made some movies out of that series, and just great books and great allegories and great imagery of biblical things. You can actually find God, the cross, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus in these books, the Christian walk, heathens coming to the Lord. And then the very last book talks about the Antichrist in the end times, and it wraps it up with a picture of heaven all the way at the end. Now, it's a fairy tale, so they have mythical creatures in it, and one of those creatures is a unicorn. And in that end of the book, there's all the people and some dwarves and the unicorn, they're all there, and they kind of went through a portal, if you will, a little place where they found themselves in heaven, but they didn't realize it yet. And so they're looking around, they're saying, things look familiar, and I feel like I've always been here, and some things look like Earth used to look, or like Narnia used to look, but you know what, it's different, something's different about this place. And finally, the unicorn realizes where they're at, and he says, this is home, this is where I belong, this is the place, this is heaven. And they start to run, and he says, farther up and farther in. Farther up and farther in. So they're all running and they're all going and they start running so fast that everybody's keeping up with each other. They're going as fast as eagles are flying and they're going across water like speedboats, and all of a sudden they're going up these waterfalls, just going straight up them like it's no problem. And as they run in, listen to what they say at the very end of the book. It says, the further up and the further in you go, the bigger everything gets. The inside is larger than the outside. See, that's how it is with God. Before you were a Christian, before you came into that saving faith in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ and you were born again, you looked at God and you said, God is large, God is big, I don't know if God's really interested in me. Maybe God's mad at me. And you had this picture of God and you thought that you knew how big was God, but then finally you surrendered, you said yes to Jesus, and you laid down your life before him and you found yourself in Christ. And the moment you stepped into Jesus Christ, you realized, my goodness, there's a lot to see here. There's a lot to do here. Look at what's going on. Look at the freedoms that I have. Look at the grace of God. Look at the forgiveness of God. Look at the love of God. But then as you tasted and you saw that the Lord was good, you started to go further up and further in. And as you got into God, you realized that the inside is much larger than the outside. And therefore, your pursuit never ends. Let me end with this today. Romans chapter 11. Romans chapter 11, once again, the Apostle Paul writes, he's talking about God. Romans chapter 11, starting in verse number 33, look at what he says. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Verse 34, for who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has become his counselor? Or who has first given to him and it shall be repaid to him? You know what the answer to that is? No one. Why? Because God is the one who initiates. God is the one who's great and mighty. Verse 36, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. In our lives, the pursuit of God will cost us something. The power of pursuing God comes with number one priority, that's the place that God takes in our life, top and center. Secondly, it comes with a passion, that our passion speaks of our soul purpose. And finally, speaks of persistence, that the pursuit never ends. Can we give the Lord a great big praise in this place today? Come on, hallelujah, stir it up today. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah. God is good. Love you guys. Thank you guys for staying put. But you guys got up and walked out, but I know that you can hear the sound of my voice down the breezeways and in the foyer, even in the bathrooms. And so I just want you guys to listen up for a moment. I want to talk to you about your life before you leave. I want to make sure that everybody in this place is right with God before you leave this place. Now, oftentimes people get off and they think that they're right with God because they've been good or because they go to church or because they were raised in church or maybe because they volunteered and helped out in church or something like that. And yet, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you get right with God, that you become a Christian because you've been good, because you volunteered, because you attended church? See, we get this thought that maybe if I just sit in a church service, call myself a Christian, that makes me a Christian. When nothing could be further from the truth. That's like me saying I can go to the Pacific Ocean, sit in the water, call myself a fish, and that makes me a fish. Now, we understand that logic, and yet with church, for some reason, we apply that logic, and we think that that's sound. And yet, you're not going to make it. And I'm here today to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. You can't be good enough to get to heaven because the standard is perfection if you're basing it off of your goodness. And the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Our goodness compared to God's goodness is like filthy rags, the Bible says. Not going to get to stay. Going to get thrown out. And today I want to make sure that you're right with God before you leave this place. Doesn't happen because you're raised in church. Doesn't happen because you're born in America. Doesn't happen because you wear religious jewelry. Because you volunteer. Doesn't happen. See, sometimes people even think, well, wait a second. I know God. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? And yet, if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Happens because you've been born again. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it through the coals. Books and movies and Hollywood and television and the internet have tried to define for us what being born again is. But today, I know you're smarter than that. Let's not let society tell us what being born again means. Let's let the Bible define for us what being born again really means. What does it mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. We're talking about being wholehearted today. So you're not going to find God with a half-hearted relationship. Not going to make it. Going to have to put everything you have into it. In fact, Jesus in the book of Revelation is speaking to a church. Very interesting. Saying these words to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, a little out. A little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Going to end up, at the end of it all, going to hell. Now you say, Pastor, hold on a second. I don't believe in hell. That's a fairy tale people made up to scare children into being good. And yet, have you read your Bible? Old and New Testament talk about hell. Jesus spoke of hell. It's a very real place. And just by denying something's existence and burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And today I'm here to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. Listen, you would be mad at me if I took a jar of poison and I put another label on it. Peppermint extract. You'd say, what are you doing? You trying to kill me by repackaging or rebranding that? That's poison. And yet, when I start to talk about hell, people say, oh, no, why would you say that? Here's why. That's a poison that's going to kill you. And I want to make sure you know the truth. I'm not going to put a fancy label on it and call it love or call it any other thing. No, this is the love of God, that Jesus came, that Jesus died, that he was buried, and that he was resurrected. And now he offers you eternal life. But you got to give them all of your heart. You got to give them all of your life. Remember, we talked about this. It's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you everything, all of your heart and all of your life, just like it cost him all of his heart and all of his life. Today, will you give God all of your heart? Today, will you give God all of your life? It's all or nothing with Jesus. In a moment, I'm going to give you this opportunity. I'm going to go like this. One, two, three, and pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now, you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that today. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever and ever? And no one make that trade. And yet, the devil thinks you're dumb enough, he's going to try and talk you out of it right now. Fear and insecurity is going to try and hold you back. But listen, you know better. You know the truth. You've seen the label. Today, you can give God all of your heart and give God all of your life in the safe and friendly church service. No one's judging you. No one's criticizing you or condemning you. We love you. We've all done this at one point or another in our lives too. Now it's your turn. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? Jesus said, you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. Will you sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right? Or will you give God all of your heart and all of your life? Now, listen. Give me your attention, okay? A lot of distractions. I want you to listen up because your eternal life is at stake. I want to make sure you understand this. Who should raise their hand? You've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand? If you're not sure about your salvation today, come on, make sure. Don't leave this place unsure. Who should raise their hand? If you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life. Come on, I'm talking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm, and you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it, come on, I'm talking to you. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or online, wherever you're at, God sees you can raise your hand, and then there's a button you can click that says respond to God or how to know God on our homepage, rockchurch.com, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Get ready to get your hands up all together on the count of three. If you know you need to do this, this is for you. One, two, three. Let me see your hands right now. Thank you. There's one. There's two. God bless you. There's three. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? There's four. Got you up there. Five, six. Thank you. Seven, eight. Got you over there. Who else today? Eight wise people already. Anybody else up there? Nine in the family rooms. Got you. Thank you. Nine wise people. Where are you at, number 10? Come on, just lift it up high. Where are you at? Thank you, number 10. Got you. God bless you. Who else today? Know you need to give God all your heart. Know you need to give God all of your life. Anybody else real quick? Just want to make sure that you get a hold of this today. This is your life. Come on. This is your eternal life. Anybody else real quick? Real quick. Want to make sure that we don't miss out on you. Come on. You've missed out on enough opportunities. This is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else? And about 10 wise people already. Anybody else? Last call. I'm going to sweep through. Thank you, 11. God bless you. Got you. Come on. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 11 wise people. Hallelujah. All right, all 11 of you, you raised your hands. God bless you guys. We're happy for you guys. We're excited for you. But listen, number 12, you're sitting out there and you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. Listen up, this is for you too. You still haven't missed out. Okay, in a moment, we're all going to stand. We're going to give a clap and a shout. As we do that, that's your cue. If you raise your hand, or you should raise your hand. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today, but we can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. And if you raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, you come right now. From the family rooms, bring your children. From the foyer, come on in. Come on, wherever you're at, come on down right now. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
Jesus, I believe.
All right, they're coming. Come on, let's give them a hand as they come.
In you.
You can come too.
Jesus, I belong to you.
They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, let's give them an encouragement. Come on down.
You're the reason.
Bring your children from the family room. Come on down.
Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah, they're still coming. There's room for you. We'll wait for you. Come on down. Come on down. They're still coming. Come on. Come on down. This is for you today. All right. All right. Hallelujah. Hey, everybody up front. Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. All right. Came to give God all your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Best decision of your entire life right there. Okay. Now, see this guy over here waving at you? All right. This is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, you already got past me, okay? I'm about as weird as you're going to encounter today. He's cool. He's going to do three things with you. I'm going to let you know what they are in advance so you're not wondering or concerned, okay? First thing he's going to do, he's going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Second thing he's going to do, he's going to give you some free information and some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that you're a Christian, what do you do next? Okay? Third thing he's going to do, he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. You heard of a physical trainer in the gym? Helps you get strong, right? Helps you get buff. Calls you, make sure you're eating the right things, okay? Spiritual personal trainer is a friend in church who will help you spiritually to get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how it works, and they'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Now listen, give us a year here at The Rock, okay? 1 year of your life sitting consistently under the teaching here at The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If you can make it to Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, come on, all right? Consistently, week after week. Maybe you can come to one of the other churches, church services like Sunday night at 6 or Wednesday night at 7, young adults ministry, women's ministry, okay? As much as you can for the next year, consistently get a hold of the teaching here at The Rock. And after that year and for the rest of your life, here's the promise. I promise you will look around your life and say, oh my goodness, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right. It all starts with a spiritual personal trainer. You guys can make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise as they go. Hallelujah. You got good.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.